good night. As you read through the Gospels, there aren't too many occasions where you find the disciples making a specific request to Jesus. But there are two that are my favorites, and we're looking at one of them in this Bible study. But my two favorites are, Lord, teach us to pray.
Yes.
And Lord, increase our faith. Those were two prayers that the apostles prayed. Mm-hmm. And I think we can learn a lot just from those two requests. And I believe they're interrelated. And we're looking more specifically these few weeks at the second one. Lord, increase our faith. They had faith. It may have been small, in their eyes anyway, and they realized that it needed to grow and it needed to increase. So we've been looking very practically at what are some ways that are indicated in Scripture that our faith can grow. And we've seen already that real faith isn't something manufactured from the human heart. Real faith comes from God. God has dealt to every one of us a measure of faith, it says in Romans 12:3. Jesus said, all you need is a mustard seed of faith, and it can grow into a huge tree. So it's not so much how big our faith is when God first gives it to us. It's how can we nurture it? How can we see that it germinates and grows and increases? Yeah. I don't know about you. I've been a believer almost 40 years, but I still find myself almost on a daily basis in situations where I realize, you know what, I wish I had more faith. And that's always the difference. And we saw at the beginning of this study that throughout the Gospels, this seemed to be almost an obsession with Jesus. Everywhere he went, he was looking at people's faith. He was talking about their faith or the lack of it. And we saw in a number of those quotations that most of the times when he spoke about people lacking faith, it was his own disciples. And so, you know, we're in good company if we find ourselves in a place where we realize we need more of this thing called faith. Faith is a mystery. We've tried to define it, but I don't think you can come up with a one-sentence definition that really encompasses what faith is, because it's a divine quality. And the very definition that's given in Hebrews 11:1 makes no sense to the carnal or the natural mind. Being sure of things that you don't have, being certain of things you can't see, I mean, they'll lock you up if you keep talking like that. The crazy people talk like that. I'm seeing things. I'm sure of things, but they're invisible. But that's the nature of faith. Faith has an ability to see through the natural into the spiritual and into the supernatural, and it's absolutely sure of the substance of those things. It gives substance to unseen things, the things that we do not yet possess. And I don't know about you, even after 40 years, there are many things in my Christian life that I'm hoping for. I don't have them yet. And faith can only operate in the realm of hope. If you already have it, then you don't need any faith. I have keys to a car. I have a phone. I don't need faith for these things. But things that I do not yet possess, but they're promised to me in God's word, that's a realm where faith needs to operate. Now, we've already talked about a number of things mentioned in Scripture that can help us grow our faith. And I don't want to waste too much time reviewing it, because I want to really get to the next one, because it's my favorite. And we're going to have an opportunity to practice this tonight, not just hear about it. But let's review real quickly. We're looking at 10 ways, and probably more, but 10 ways to build our faith. And let me just preface this again by saying, real faith must originate from God. He's the author and the finisher of our faith. But there are very clear scriptures that put the responsibility on us to nurture and to grow that faith. Number one, and this is at the top of the list for good reason, and I think you'll see how this even connects with number six that we're going to be introducing tonight. Number one was saturate yourself in the Word of God. I cannot emphasize that enough. Just, you cannot get enough of this. And store it inside. Memorize it. Study it. Learn it inside and out. And the more this Word becomes a part of you, the more faith has an opportunity to grow. And one of my favorite scriptures on faith is faith comes by hearing. And hearing comes from the Word of God. So there are two steps. We need to develop our sense of hearing that comes from studying the Word of God. And then real faith comes when you start hearing God. And the ability to hear God's voice and understand what He's saying is based on the Word of God. Let me tell you, there's a lot of confusion in Christian circles today because people don't really know the Word of God. And they hear all kinds of voices. Oh, God told me this. God told me to do that. Well, the Bible says if they don't speak according to this Word, there's no light in them. So this is the ultimate guide, the ultimate judge of everything we hear, of everything we do. And again, the better we know this, the safer we are when we hear a voice. And if it's in line with the scripture, then we're safe. But there have been a lot of people that have heard voices that are saying things contrary to this Word. Reject them. Reject them. Number two, we talked about the importance of praying in the Spirit, being filled with the Holy Spirit. Jude 20 says, build yourselves up. That's your responsibility. Build yourselves up in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit. And we likened it to the fact that a battery needs to be recharged because it's continually draining out its power. Well, praying in the Spirit is one way that we can recharge ourselves. I don't know about you, but when I'm in my car, when I'm walking around in my house, I'm speaking in tongues, I'm praying in the Spirit. Sometimes my wife laughs at me. She says, you sound like a crazy man. I said, so what? Everybody else is crazy. Why not pray in the Spirit? Why not get filled with the Holy Spirit? Sometimes I'll be in the car driving and somebody will pull up next to me and the stereo system in their car is so loud the whole ground is shaking and they're there in their car and they're doing all this. You know what I do? I roll down my window and I start singing in the Spirit, praising God as loud as I can. I mean, the whole world's going crazy. Why can't we be crazy for Jesus? And get filled with the Holy Spirit. You'll find that your faith gets recharged when you do it. All right, point number three we've already looked at. A couple of do nots to help us in our faith growth. Don't trust in your own feelings. Don't trust in your own understanding. We all have our own feelings. We all have our own understanding, but they can fool you and they can rob you of what God is wanting to do supernaturally through His Word. Trust in the Lord with all your brain. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. It doesn't mean we're just fools. It doesn't mean we don't have any brains or any understanding, but there are times where we need to set our understanding of things aside and trust God because He has spoken something to us in His Word. Be careful with your own perception of things. What did we see? We walk by faith, not by sight. So walking by sight can be a real hindrance to walking by faith. Leaning on our own understanding of things can hinder us from trusting in God with our whole heart. And then fourth, that went right along with that, we looked at a number of scriptures that warn us about not trusting in man, not putting people in the place of God, not trusting in flesh, not trusting in worldly systems or worldly help. And we saw a number of scriptures where God spoke very strongly to the children of Israel in the Old Testament, to the point that he said, "Cursed is the man that trusts in man, whose heart departs from the Lord." You see, God wants our heart. That's what he's really interested in here. And when we start diverting our faith away from God into other things or other people, he's losing our heart. And that's what really grieves him. He wants us to trust him with our whole heart. Point number five we finished with last time. This one has been a real help to me, especially when you're going through a dark time. Now, I know that never happens to anyone else here, but just in case it ever happens in the future, make a note to yourself. When I'm going through a dark time, yes, when I'm going through difficulties, remember all of the miracles that God has done in your life. Mm-hmm. Either keep a mental journal or a written journal. Better still, talk about what God's done in your life all the time so you never forget. Mm-hmm. Some of the testimonies I have in my own life, I've told them, I don't know how many hundreds of times. Mm-hmm. And you know what? I don't get tired of telling them. Maybe you've gotten tired of hearing some of them. Sorry for that. But I like to talk about what God's done. And some of the most amazing miracles, you just cannot tire of talking about them. They're so amazing. They're so marvelous. And we looked at a number of scriptures and Psalms where it tells us to do that. Remember God's works. Tell other people about the miracles, the signs, the wonders, the answers to prayer. Tell your testimony to other people, and I guarantee you, you'll find your faith gets recharged and energized. Now, that leads me into point six. This is a biggie. If you want your faith to grow, learn how to talk faith. Speak faith. It may not make a whole lot of sense if you haven't heard this before, but the mouth is a very integral part of your faith life and your faith growth. So important that we're going to look at one scripture in Romans 10 where it seems that without the mouth speaking, salvation itself cannot be complete. Let's begin in 2 Corinthians 4, a very interesting scripture where Paul, as he often does, he'll take an obscure Old Testament scripture and quote it, but through the Holy Spirit, he's bringing it to a whole different light. And he's teaching on faith here. And he says in 2 Corinthians 4 and verse 13, 2 Corinthians 4, 13. It is written, that means he's quoting from the Old Testament. I think it's Psalm 116. I believed, therefore I have spoken. That's it. I believed, therefore I have spoken. And some of you have heard me say this many times, but I'll say it again. Whenever the word therefore is in the scriptures, it's there for a reason. And you need to stop and ask, what's the therefore? What's it connecting? Notice the order here. I believed, and I'm putting this in parentheses, I believed first, then, or because of that, I have spoken. Belief, speaking. There's an order there that he's trying to establish. And then he adds his own interpretation. With that same spirit of faith, we also believe and therefore speak. Now, before we go any further, the order here is important. Some people go around speaking, 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 thinking they can speak some magic into existence. Oh, Pastor, I'm claiming a new BMW. And they think that just by saying that, you know, they're going to get some magic trick done by God and they're going to find a new BMW in their driveway. No, it says, I have first believed. So there must be real faith in the heart. Then it needs to express itself through our mouth, through speaking. The next scripture will help me to explain it more. Romans 10, from verse 8 to 10. Romans 10, 8 to 10. And verses 9 and 10 are probably some of the most often quoted scriptures in evangelistic tracts, evangelistic sermons. As soon as you get there, you'll recognize these verses. But I think there's a deeper meaning than what is often brought out. Listen carefully. What does it say? The word is near you. It is in your what? In your mouth. Interesting. The word is near you. It is in your mouth and in your heart. That is the word of faith we are proclaiming. That if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are what?
Saved.
And are saved. So the heart and the mouth are both integral parts of our salvation. And there's a word that Paul uses here several times. It's the word confess. Very important to understand that word. If you confess with your mouth, it says in verse 9, and then again in verse 10, it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you confess and are saved. The Greek word is homologeo. We have words like monologue, dialogue. This would be homologue. A monologue is when one person's speaking. A dialogue is when two people are speaking. A homologue simply means speaking the same thing. That's literally what it means. Speaking the same thing. What does that mean here? If you confess with your mouth, if you speak the same thing with your mouth, and whenever you have this concept, speaking the same thing, the first question comes to your mind is, same as what? Same means it's being compared or connected with some other word, some other speech. In this case, the whole concept of biblical confession is I'm saying the same thing God says in his word. I'm getting in line with what God says and I'm saying the same thing. That's what confession is. So important is our mouth in this whole process of faith that it's mentioned three times here, mouth and heart, mouth and heart, mouth and heart. We believe in the heart, but then something else needs to happen to sort of seal the deal. We believe in our heart, then we say the same thing with our mouth. Confession is absolutely vital to our faith. What we say matters. And I don't have time tonight. I could literally pull up probably 25 scriptures just from the book of Proverbs that all talk about the power of the tongue. We'll just look at one. And I think this is sufficient to open your mind to the importance of this. Proverbs 18 and verse 21. What does it say?
The tongue has the power of life and death, and those who love it will eat its fruit.
The tongue has the power of life and death. Wow. No wonder James says the tongue is such a tiny little member, but it's really like the rudder that steers the whole ship. And I believe there is enough evidence in Scripture, and we'll look at some of it here tonight, to prove that you either speak life or death with your mouth. You either pronounce blessing or cursing. You speak what God speaks, or you contradict what God speaks by the things you say. And here again, the better we know God's word, the more we can begin to come into line with what God says and say the same thing he's saying. So God says, if we repent and believe, we're saved, right? Yeah. So if I keep going around for years and years doubting that and saying, I don't know if God loves me. I don't know if God forgives me. I don't feel forgiven, so I don't think I'm saved yet. What are you really doing? You're calling God a liar. You're going completely against what God has said, so you're not saying the same thing. And you can take any promise of God. You're either going to agree with that promise and believe it in your heart and begin to confess that and speak that as truth. It may not be a reality yet, because remember, faith is operating in the realm of things hoped for and things that we do not yet see. But we're convinced by the Spirit of God and by the Word of God that it's true. And therefore, we begin to speak the same things that God has spoken. The power of life and death is in the tongue. And Jesus spoke about the mouth and what comes out of it on several occasions. Let's look at one of them in Matthew 12 from verse 33. Matthew 12, and notice again in this passage the connection between the heart and the mouth. He says, make a tree good, and its fruit will be good. Or, make a tree bad, and its fruit will be bad. For a tree is recognized by its fruit. You brood of vipers, how can you who are evil say anything good? For out of the overflow of the heart, the what?
Mouth.
The mouth speaks. The good man brings good things out of the good, and pay attention to this, the good stored up in him, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. Did you know your heart is like a storage tank? You're storing things in it. Either positive, faith-filled, godly, scriptural things, or ungodly, worldly things that are contrary to God are being stored up in your heart. Everybody's storing something. He says, the good man is storing good stuff, the evil man is storing evil stuff. So everybody's storing things in their hearts. And you probably heard that saying, garbage in, garbage out. If you fill your mind and your heart with garbage through the internet, through books, through videos, through TV, through bad conversation, et cetera, et cetera, that's what's in you. And it's going to overflow. Whatever's stored in the heart will eventually come out of the mouth. Now, let me read this again slowly. The good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him. Now, I haven't finished reading it yet, but we're already getting a picture here. The good things are being stored in the heart. How does he bring them out? It says he brings out those good things. I think when we finish reading this, we're going to see it's through the mouth. The good stored in the heart eventually has to come out through the mouth. And evil stored in the heart eventually comes out of the mouth too. The good man brings good things out of the good stored up in him, and the evil man brings evil things out of the evil stored up in him. But I tell you that men will have to give an account on the day of judgment for every careless word they have spoken. For by your words you will be acquitted, and by your words you will be condemned. Talk about the power of words, the power of the tongue. There it is in New Testament language. But go back again to this phrase that we all know very well in verse 34. Out of the overflow of the heart, the mouth speaks. King James, I think, says out of the abundance of the heart. So whatever is abounding inside of us is eventually going to find its way through our mouth. You ever said something and you're like, where did that come from? It came from your heart. And sometimes God will use that to show you, I need to do some heart cleaning. I got some junk in me. And it just popped out through my mouth. And you know, you can't just put a muzzle on your mouth. He says, out of the overflow, it's something that just eventually spills out. So if you keep harboring bitterness against someone, I guarantee it's going to come out. If you keep harboring anger against someone or something or whatever it is that you have issues with, if you don't deal with that, it just keeps festering, and it eventually it's going to explode. So we don't have time tonight to talk too much about it, but deal with the heart. You know, out of the heart are the issues of life. We need to be very careful to guard our heart, guard what's being put in there. And this takes me back to point number one. Saturate yourself in the Word of God. Store up the Word of God in your heart. Memorize it. Learn it. Sing it. Talk about it. Talk to yourself. I don't care if people think you're crazy. Quote the scriptures to yourself if you have to. But build up a storage of truth and scripture in your heart, and then you'll find it begins to come out of your mouth. All right. A classic scripture that is often used in this context that we're speaking here in point number six is Mark chapter 11. Mark 11, and what prompted this was when Jesus spoke to a fig tree and it died. Remember that?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, that's another whole Bible study. I mean, why Jesus is going around cursing trees, but he just spoke to a tree and it died. Talk about the power of words. And this captured the disciples' attention. Because a little later, they went by the tree again, and it was dead. Now, I don't know what they thought, if Jesus was just playing around with them, or he was just in a bad mood or something, but they were a little bit surprised when they said, hey, the tree you cursed died, Lord. And in verse 20, It says, in the morning, as they went along, they saw the fig tree withered from the roots. Peter remembered, I love Peter. Peter remembered, and he said to Jesus, Rabbi, look, the fig tree you cursed has withered. Mark 11, 21. This is a teachable moment for Jesus. And he doesn't waste it. He says, have faith in God. Have faith in God. I tell you the truth. If anyone says, remember, Jesus said something to the tree and it died. They're now marveling that the tree is dead. Jesus is teaching them, have faith in God, but he jumps right into what you say. I tell you the truth, if anyone says to this mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, there it is again, the heart and the mouth. He says to the mountain, go throw yourself into the sea, and does not doubt in his heart, but believes that what he says will happen, it will be done for him. Therefore, I tell you, whatever you ask for in prayer, believe that you have received it, and it will be yours. Now, here's a moment of truth for us. Have you ever really prayed about something? Oh, Lord, do this. Oh, Lord, 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 Lord. And as soon as you finish praying, you get up and you say, that's never going to happen. And do I have any company here? Okay, my hand's up. I mean, is that dumb or what? You just wasted an hour praying, 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 praying. And then as soon as you get up, oh, I know that's not going to happen. What did you just do? You just spoke the opposite of what God said in his word, number one, if you're praying over a promise or something that he's spoken to you. Plus, you're speaking death instead of life with your mouth. And I don't think it's any coincidence that God created the universe how? By speaking. Wow. He said, let there be light. Mm-hmm. Do you think God believed it was going to happen? Or was he like sweating? I don't know if this is going to work or not. I'm going to try it. Let's see if we get any light or not. No. He knew. His word has that kind of power. And the Bible talks about two aspects of faith. And it connects it with the faith of Abraham, which we haven't really talked about yet, but we will. Abraham's faith basically boils down to two aspects. Number one, it was a faith that believes in a God who can raise the dead. When he was ready to sacrifice Isaac, the Bible says he believed that even if he put him to death, God was going to raise him from the dead. That's amazing. He had faith that God could raise the dead. Yes. The second thing about Abraham's faith, he believed in a God who can speak into existence things that do not exist. He speaks into existence things that did not previously exist. That's powerful. And so when we're talking about confession, when we're talking about our mouth being an important part of faith, we need to carefully consider all these things. What we say matters. And again, this isn't some magic trick where we just go around saying a bunch of foolishness. No, we're seeking God, we're saturated in the Word of God, we're hearing from God, and once we hear from God, we have real faith in our heart, and then we start speaking in agreement with what God has said. Let's look at a few more scriptures. Revelation 12. Revelation chapter 12, verses 10 and 11. Got it? It says, then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God and the authority of his Christ. For the accuser of our brothers, that of course is Satan, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They overcame him by the blood of the Lamb, but by something else also. By the word of their testimony. The word of their confession. So, sure, the blood of the Lamb is what gives us victory over the devil. But our mouth is integrally involved. It's equally important. We overcome by the word of our testimony. Look also in Hebrews chapter 10. There's quite a bit in the scriptures on this. Hebrews 10. Starting with verse 22, we'll read 22 and 23. Hebrews 10, 22 and 23. Let us draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience. We're going to come back to this in our next point. And we're going to talk about the importance of keeping a clean conscience. So just make a note, because we're going to come back to this verse for that. But it says, draw near to God with a sincere heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. How does verse 23 read in the King James? I think it's a little closer to the actual
Let us reading. Hold fast to the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised.
Hold fast to the profession of our faith.
Without wavering.
It's the same word we saw in Romans 10, speaking the same thing. Literally, it's confession of our faith. Hold fast to the confession of our faith. And my experience is, if you're going to hold fast to something, it takes energy, doesn't it? It's not something that automatically happens. You have to be involved. You have to will to hold on to that thing. It's not just going to happen. So faith is something we have to fight for. Faith is something we have to be very much involved in, this process of holding on to it. Well, what's the opposite of holding on to something?
Letting go.
Letting go. We read a whole bunch of verses about how many people in these last days are letting go of their faith. They're drifting away. They're falling away. So it's going to take an investment of energy on my part to keep holding on to the confession of my faith. Because, let's face it, when all kinds of negative voices and negative reports and negative input is surrounding you, you start to feel like, I guess God didn't really mean what he said. And our confession starts to change. We start to speak negative. We start to speak doubt. We start to speak fear. We start to speak all the things that the devil wants us to say. And we're now saying the same thing he's saying. Because he's an accuser. He's accusing God of being a liar. And very often so are we by our negative confession. Oh, God's not going to take care of me. He never does. God never answers my prayers. Listen to you. What did you just do? You just called God a liar. And yet it goes on all the time in Christian circles. We need to fight, hold unswervingly to the confession of our faith. You know, I had an experience years ago that I just will never forget. And God taught me something that day about holding on. I don't know if you've ever ridden on the back of a motorcycle. I don't think I'll ever do it again. But this pastor said, come on, get on. I said, where are we going? Oh, no, we're just going to go for a little spin. Well, we went out on the beltway. And I mean, we were going 65 miles an hour. And the only thing between me and eternity was these two hands. And I'm not making this up. I held on so tight, my knuckles turned white. And when we finally got to the destination, I couldn't unlock my hands. They had literally frozen like this around the bars of his seat. And I had to kind of peel off my fingers to get my hands free. And the Lord spoke to me immediately, you need to hold on to me like that. You need to hold on to my word like that. Because there are things that are going to want to throw you off to the right or throw you off to the left. Hold unswervingly. Now, here's another interesting scripture. Joshua chapter 1. I don't know. Not much is told us about Joshua in his early days here. But something tells me he had a problem with getting discouraged, with being afraid, with feeling maybe like he couldn't measure up to being Moses' successor. I mean, come on. This is the guy that parted the Red Sea, delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, worked all kinds of miracles and signs and wonders, and now all of a sudden Moses is dead and Joshua has to fill his boots. And notice how many times God tells Joshua not to get discouraged, not to be afraid, but to be courageous and to be strong. From verse 6, Joshua 1, verse 6. Be strong and courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land I swore to their forefathers to give them. Be strong and very courageous. God, you just said that, but you added very. You know, when God keeps repeating himself, it's good to pay attention. Be strong and courageous. Be strong and very courageous. Verse 7. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave you. Do not turn from it to the right or to the left, that you may be successful wherever you go. Now listen carefully to verse 8. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mind? From your heart? No. God's very specific. Do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? And by the way, here's a third one, Joshua. Be strong and courageous. Do not be terrified. Do not be discouraged. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. What a strange thing. Don't let this book of the law depart from your mouth. It's the key to your success. Meditate on it day and night. You know, years ago, I heard a preacher explaining real biblical meditation. There are all kinds of meditations in the world today. We're not talking about those. We're talking about meditating on the Word of God. Mm-hmm. Meditating, in a biblical sense, is not just thinking about something. The word in the original Hebrew literally means to mutter or to murmur. And really what it implies is you're talking to yourself, kind of under your breath, but maybe you're talking to yourself. Well, in this context, what is Joshua supposed to be talking? The Word of God. Meditate on the Word of God. Speak the Word of God to yourself. Keep repeating it over and over and over. And you'll find the more you do that, the more this connection between the heart and the mouth becomes solidified. Mm-hmm. And you find your faith becomes more and more like concrete. It's unshakable, it's unmovable, because what you believe in your heart is what you're saying with your mouth. All right, a couple more scriptures, and then I'm going to pass these out, and we're going to do it. We're going to practice confessing our faith tonight. But these two scriptures I have found very helpful in understanding the power of this whole thing. We're not just reading poetry or, you know, some good philosophy. This is the Word of God. This Word is living and powerful. And so when it's in your mouth, what do you have in your mouth? A sharp, two-edged sword, the Bible says. Look in Hebrews chapter 4. Verse 12. Hebrews 4:12. What does it say? For the Word of God is dead. It's just an old book. Y'all are reading about stories that are centuries old. I don't know how you can believe any of this stuff. That's what the modern person says. The Word of God is living. This is a living Word. And it's active. It's powerful. It's energizing. And it is sharper than any double-edged sword. It penetrates even to dividing soul and spirit, joints and marrow. It judges the thoughts and attitudes of the heart. The Word of God, living and powerful. And I think we all know in Ephesians 6, the whole list of armor there that we are to put on daily as soldiers of Christ. No soldier would dare go into battle unarmed without any kind of defense or protection. It's suicide. And yet very often as Christians, we're entering into an unseen battle that is very, very intense and very, very serious. And I mentioned this the other day. Sometimes we as Christians, we're playing games, we're playing church. The devil's not playing games. He's playing for keeps. He's playing to kill, steal, and destroy. And we better understand the nature of this battle. It's not a game. And we need to put on the whole armor. And it says here in Ephesians 6 from verse 10, Finally, be strong in the Lord and his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you have done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation. Now stop right there. Everything that we've read so far in that list, it's all defensive armor. It's just to protect you. Protect your head, protect your vital organs, protect your feet, etc. The only thing left in the list is the only offensive weapon in Paul's whole list. From verse 17 again, take the helmet of salvation, that's to protect your head, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The sword of the Spirit. So, when we have the Word of God in our mouth, we have an offensive weapon with which we can do battle with powers, principalities, these rulers of darkness. The only offensive weapon in this list is the sword of the Spirit, the Word of God. And when we have the Word of God in our mouth, we have a sword with which we can do battle. And I think we need to learn more how to use our mouth in spiritual warfare, both through prayer and through confession. Again, confessing, saying the same thing God is saying about a situation. And once we know what God has said about something, we become convinced of the truthfulness of it, then we begin to agree with God. Lord, I agree with you. It is written in your word, such and such and such and such, and therefore I will declare the same thing in agreement with your word. You remember the story of the 12 spies that went into the promised land? Very powerful story. They chose a representative from each one of the 12 tribes to go in and spy out this land that God had already told them about, a land flowing with milk and honey, a place of unbelievable abundance and prosperity and beauty. Nevertheless, they wanted to kind of verify what God had spoken. So they sent these 12 spies in to the promised land. They spent 40 days there, and they even gathered some of the fruit from the promised land, brought it back for the Israelites to see. Do you remember what happened? All but two of the 12 spies came back and they said, yeah, it's a good land. Yeah, it flows with milk and honey. Yeah, here are the grapes we brought back. Huge grapes. Marvelous place. Wonderful fruit. But there are giants there. And we cannot overcome them. We cannot go in. We cannot possess this land. What were they doing? They were calling God a liar. God had already told them, I will go before you as a devouring fire. There are seven nations in there stronger and more powerful than you are. Doesn't matter. I'll destroy all of them. You just go in by faith, I'll march before you, I'll destroy all your enemies. I'll bring down all the walled cities, I'll bring down all the giants, I'll destroy the seven nations and all the 31 kings that are in there. Not to worry. I'm going to give you this land because I've sworn it on oath to Abraham. No, 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 no. We can't, we can't, we can't. You know what? They didn't. Because what they said is what they got. They spoke unbelief. They spoke death. And that's exactly what happened to them. They all died in the wilderness. Not a single one of those 10 spies ever went in. Joshua and Caleb were the other two spies. The Bible says they had a different spirit. What spirit did they have? They had a spirit of faith. How do we know? Because of the way they spoke. After all the other spies discouraged everyone, and you know, somehow negative news travels faster than good news. Have you noticed that?
Yeah.
And it seems to affect people faster when it's negative. So man, their evil report spread throughout all the tribes of Israel. And everybody was discouraged. Everybody was saying, what has this Moses done? He's brought us out here into the desert to kill us. Let's go back to Egypt. And they were messed up. The whole congregation got messed up by these 10 spies. But Joshua and Caleb, they stood up. They said, hold on a minute. Give me your attention. And basically what they said is, we believe God. Don't listen to these men. Don't listen to their discouragement. Don't listen to their fear. Don't listen to all the negative words they're speaking. If God delights in us, he will give us the land. And all these enemies and all these giants, they will be bread for us. Mm-hmm. We are well able to overcome.
Yes.
That's what they said. We are well able to overcome. Guess what? They did.
Amen.
What they spoke is what they believed, and that's what they got. Joshua and Caleb entered in. All the other naysayers and negative speakers, they died in the desert. And we talked about a law that Jesus stated, according to your faith, be it unto you. The 10 spies got what they believed. Joshua and Caleb got what they believed. And you can tell what they believed by what came out of their mouth. That's a powerful story. If you're not familiar with it, read it in Numbers 13 and 14. It's a very powerful story. And what it says there is Joshua and Caleb had a different spirit. I don't know about you, I want that spirit.
Yes.
I don't want to go around saying, I can't, I won't, nothing good's ever going to happen, and then die in the desert, getting everything that I declared. I'd rather be saying, we are well able, I am saved, I am healed, I am more than a conqueror in Christ, I can walk on water, I can do signs and wonders, God is able.
Amen.
And get what I believe, and get what I say, because I'm saying what I believe. You know, there's a time where you are going to have to learn a very important lesson that King David had learned. And we're not going to take time to look at the story, but it's found in 1 Samuel 30, where David was in a real low spot. And the enemies had come in and raided a city where he and all of his men and his wives and children and everybody had encamped, a place called Ziklag. And the enemies had come in and plundered the whole town and stolen all their wives and children. And when David and his men came back to the city, they found all their families gone. They found all their possessions and everything plundered by the enemy. And everybody started weeping and crying But it gets worse. The Bible says they all spoke of stoning David. You know, everybody wants to be a leader, right? Be careful. Because when things aren't going well, who do they always go after? The leader. Stoning! They never stop to think, how is stoning David going to help anything? But you know, you're just acting out of emotion. Stone this guy. You know what it says? David encouraged himself in the Lord. And he was able to turn the whole situation around. They went and defeated the enemies, and they reclaimed all their wives, all their children, and all the stuff that the enemy had stolen from them. But the key in the whole story is that one little line, David encouraged himself in the Lord. We better learn how to do that. Now, I don't know about you, I love it when a brother or a sister calls me or pats me on the back or gives me a thank you card, something to encourage me. I like that. Everybody likes to be encouraged, right? But what do you do when nobody's encouraging you? You better learn how to encourage yourself. And again, people may think you're nuts, but you may need to talk to yourself. King David talks to himself in the Psalms. Do you realize that? He speaks to his own heart. He speaks to his own soul. We've been singing that song, which, by the way, we heard the other night was the song of the year. They did these, Dove Awards? And it was the number one Christian song for the year. Bless the Lord, O my soul, that one we've been singing. What is he saying? Bless the Lord, O my soul. Who's he talking to? He's talking to his soul. He's talking to himself. In that particular line of Psalm 103, he's not talking to God, he's talking to himself. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Come on, bless his holy name.
Yes, Lord.
Forget not all of his benefits. Who's he talking to? He's talking to himself. Sometimes we need to give ourselves a pep talk. You ever had to do that? Oh, I do it all the time. I talk to myself. Come on, Wayne, get with it. Come on, be encouraged. God's real. God's on your side. God's going to fight this battle. Don't be discouraged. Trust in the Lord. Nothing's too hard for the Lord. And you start to encourage yourself. And an integral part of that is speaking
the word.
Speaking the word. Speaking faith. Now, I'm going to pass these around. This is something that my wife and I put together when we were in Ohio, and I don't think we've made too many changes since then. It's rather long, and you may not be able to do this all in one sitting, but we used to. And you know, they say if you do something over and over, what is it, for 21 days, it actually becomes a habit. Well, we did this day after day after day, to the point that now I've pretty much, I mean, I can't speak it from memory, but it's in me now. And we were going through a really dark time when we did this. And some of the things in here are just speaking into darkness, speaking into a situation that looks hopeless, but you know what God has said. And there's one line in here that you'll see, I forget where it is, probably about getting victory over your enemies, where, yeah, it says, the Lord will grant that every enemy that rises up against me will be defeated. They will come at me from one direction, but flee in seven. Okay? We were doing that one morning in our house in Ohio, and we got to that particular part, and I stopped my wife and I said, hold on a minute. I went, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. We have seven doors in our house. Wow. And I mean, the anointing fell on us, I stood up and I said, devil, I don't care which door you use. You can choose from any one of the seven, but you are fleeing from this place.
Yes.
We are resisting you in the name of Jesus. Get out. Let me tell you something. The word of God is powerful. So what you have here is a confession as much as possible. All it is scripture. And all the references are given at the bottom of each page. And there's a little footnote that directs you where that particular part of this confession came from. And so if you want to, you can go look up all of these verses. There are a mere 187 scripture quotations in this confession. It's a little bit extreme, but you know what? When you're in an extreme battle, you need extreme weapons, like nuclear bombs. And we're going to pass this around, and we're just going to go through a couple of these sections. I challenge you, if you've never done this before, do this once a day for a month. And you tell me you don't have more faith at the end of it. You tell me that you don't realize something different is going on in your life after you have gotten into the practice of speaking the word of God. And we're gonna do a couple of these sections, and I think you'll get a taste of what I'm talking about. It is, well, with all the little references at the bottom, it's 11 pages. And it used to take us, what, about 20 minutes? Half an hour? Huh? Half an hour. Which is, you know, one short TV show. We don't think much of spending a half an hour in front of the boob tube, right? To watch some stupid sitcom for half an hour. This is a half an hour far better spent. What?
Yes.
All right, let's just do a couple of these together. How's our time looking here? Okay. Dear God, are you with me?
Yeah.
I need to hear you.
Dear God.
Are you ready?
Yes.
Okay. Dear God, because your word says that the tongue has the power of life and death, and that we overcome the devil by the word of our testimony, and since your word says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so, therefore I, like Ezekiel, will prophesy through the dry bones of my life. And just as Jesus did in the wilderness, I will declare, it is written. The word of faith is near me. It is in my heart and in my mouth. Therefore, with my heart I will believe, and with my mouth I will confess your word unto salvation. Because I believe, I also speak. With the same spirit of faith, I believe, and therefore I speak. You spoke the worlds into existence by your mighty word, and you call into being things that do not exist. You are always watching over your word to perform it. Your word says that my tongue is like the pen of a skillful writer, and that I can write your word on the tablet of my heart. Regardless of the situations in my life, I declare that you are good all the time, and your mercy and love are everlasting. God, it is because of your great love that we are not consumed. Your compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. All of your exceeding great and precious promises are yes in Christ, and we say amen to each and every one of them. Your word is true, forever settled and firm in heaven. It is impossible for you to lie. Even when we are faithless, you remain faithful.
Amen.
I don't know about you, I feel better already.
Yes.
Praise God. I feel demons just fleeing away. They can't stand the word of God. Let's read the next section. The blessing of Abraham. Good. Because I believe in your Son, Jesus Christ, my Savior and Lord, I am a child of Abraham. And because I have faith, I am blessed along with Abraham. Since I belong to Christ, I am Abraham's seed, and I am an heir according to the promise. Everything that was promised to Abraham is mine
through Jesus Christ.
Like Isaac, I am also a child of promise. As a child of Abraham, you have promised to bless me. My children will be blessed. The works of my hands will be blessed. I will be blessed when I go out and when I come in. My house will be blessed and my crops will be blessed. You will bless me and make me a blessing to nations. You have blessed me with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly realms in Christ. All the people on the earth will see that I am called by your name and they will fear you. You will give me descendants like the stars in the sky, and they will take possession of the cities of their enemies. Through them, all nations on the earth will be blessed. You have made me the head and not the tail. I will always be at the top, never at the bottom. I will be fruitful and prosperous. I will lend to nations, but borrow from none. I will have abundant prosperity so that I can be a blessing to many and meet the needs of others. Our barns will be filled with every kind of provision. Our sheep will increase by thousands, by tens of thousands in our fields. There will be no breaching of walls, no going into captivity, no cry of distress in our streets. Blessed are the people whose God is the Lord. Let's go over to page 3. Victory over enemies. I like this one. Ready?
Yes.
The Lord will grant that every enemy that rises up against me will be defeated. They will come at me from one direction, but flee in seven. Let God arise, and all his enemies be scattered. The Lord will march out like a mighty man, like a warrior. He will stir up his zeal. With a shout, he will raise the battle cry and will triumph over his enemies. God's light shines into the darkness, and the darkness cannot overcome it. Even when the enemy comes in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord will lift up a standard against him. No weapon formed against me will prevail, and God will refute every tongue that accuses me. As a servant of the Lord, this is my heritage, and my vindication comes from the Lord. Thanks be to God, who always leads me in his triumph. I believe that Jesus, the Son of God, was manifested to destroy every work of the devil, and that through his death on the cross, he destroyed him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and freed me from the fear of death. Jesus now holds the keys of hell and death. Everyone who is born of God overcomes the world. This is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. It is not by human might or power, but by your Spirit, that every mountain and obstacle is flattened. Jesus is building his church, and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. God has given me authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and to overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing will harm me. I am strong in the Lord stand against the devil's schemes. I know that when I resist the devil, he must flee from me. Praise God. Let's go to the last page. Thanksgiving and praise. Ready? I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. It is good to give thanks to the Lord in every circumstance and situation. I will give thanks, for this is God's will for me in Christ Jesus. I will be joyful always, continually offering up the sacrifice of praise to my God. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. He is the rock. His works are perfect, and all his ways are just. A faithful God who does no wrong, upright and just is he. Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed. For his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain to receive power and wealth and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and praise. To him who sits on the throne and to the Lamb be praise and honor and glory and power forever and ever. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. You know, there's a concept that we didn't really talk about too much, but it's found back on page one here, about halfway. Let me see if I can find it now. Yeah, about halfway down in that Dear God opening paragraph. If you can find number nine, see the little number nine? And then it says, your word says, your word says that my tongue is like the pen of a skillful writer. That's found in Psalm 45. Let's go there real quick. This is a messianic psalm. This is a psalm that speaks about the Messiah, Jesus. And we know that because if you drop down to verse 6, this is a direct quotation found in Hebrews chapter 1. And the writer of Hebrews attributes this to Jesus. So this is indeed a messianic psalm. But go back to verse 1. It says, my heart is stirred by a noble theme as I recite my verses for the king. My tongue is the pen of a skillful writer. Very interesting. So he's reciting his verses for the king. And as the verses, the scriptures, are being recited, he has this tremendous revelation that something's being written. The tongue is a pen. Tongue is the pen of a skillful writer. Well, where is it writing?
In your heart.
It's writing it on your heart. This is very powerful. As you go through this, over and over and over, what you're really doing is reciting verses for the king. He already knows them. He doesn't need to hear them. But as you recite them, this is getting inscribed on your heart. And you may not be able to quote every one of these scriptures by memory, but you'll find the more you do this, the more this gets written on your heart. And so when a trial of sickness or some other enemy or challenge or problem arises, you just find the Word of God is there to do battle with that particular enemy or with that particular situation. And so when it says here, your word says that my tongue is like the pen of a skillful writer, and that I can write your word on the tablet of my heart. Write your word on the tablet of my heart. There's another quotation given there in Proverbs chapter 3. And I would really recommend, when you have the time, look up every one of these scripture references so that you can see what you're speaking is really in line directly with the Word of God. But in Proverbs 3, and verse 3, it says, let love and faithfulness never leave you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And verse 1 says, my son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart, for they will prolong your life many years and bring you prosperity. So really what we're doing here is, this is an exercise whereby we're writing the Word of God upon our hearts. And some of these scriptures, you may be so inspired by them, you want to memorize the whole verse. That's fine. That's fine. This is not so much to be memorized, but it's to be spoken, confessed. And understand, several things are happening as you're doing that. You're doing battle with enemies because you have a sharp two-edged sword in your mouth as you're speaking the Word of God, and it's also writing it upon your own heart. And I think it also quotes it here somewhere, that's how Jesus did battle with Satan in the wilderness. It is written. Don't try to reason with the devil. Don't get into a big long argument with him. Just read him his doom. Say, Satan, let's make this short and sweet. It says right here, he destroyed you on the cross through his death. He destroyed him who had the power of death, even the devil. And by the way, it also says here, you're going to be thrown into the lake of fire. End of story. Good night. The Word of God is powerful. We need to use it as intended. It's an offensive weapon. But words do no good unless they are spoken. Let's pray.
The Word of God came to you from New Life Ministries here in Maryland. Now may the Word of God bless you, strengthen you, and bring you peace as you persevere in your Christian walk. I am Pastor Kwesi Ojenga.